evening, everyone. If you could please take your seats. We had a great half hour of socializing and talking about the first event of the Man's Inhumanity to Man and our week of remembrance, actually, the Armenian Genocide commemoration, which we had on Tuesday. I hope all of you had a chance to be there. Did you like it? Thank you. It just is a result of a lot of hard work by all of our committee members and the city of Glendale to try and put on a very classy event. And we think, those of us on the committee, that that's probably the premier genocide commemoration event in the United States. We can't think of another city or another region that has such an event that's done in quite the same type of quality in such a great venue as we have at the Alex Theater. So thank you all for participating. And tonight is the second event of our Week of Remembrance. We hold two events, the Armenian Genocide Commemoration, and tonight is the Man's Inhumanity to Man event. And in the past, we've done several different iterations of this. We've had panel discussions on genocides in general. We've had discussions in particular on some of the Darfur atrocities that went on. We've had speakers. Father Vasken Movsesian has spoken to us several times about his firsthand witnessing of some of the remnants of that genocide. This year, we wanted to try something a little different. And it was our intention to be fresh and exciting. And after all, we're in the film capital of the United States. We're Hollywood adjacent. So we thought, what better way to encourage the individuals who have strong feelings about genocide and atrocities and man's inhumanity to man and human slavery and organ harvesting and all these other just terrible inhumanities, which unfortunately are going on today. What better way to highlight them than to create a film competition? And we started about 6 weeks ago by announcing it. And as you know, we opened the competition to anyone on any of those subjects. And the only limitation was essentially a 15-minute maximum length and a DVD format. And tonight, we will be screening those top three award winners. And as you know, there are cash prizes involved. We thought that would help encourage filmmakers to prepare their work for us. And I think it's going to be a very interesting evening. We're also going to be joined later by a Holocaust survivor who will be introduced in more detail a little bit later. Rafi Manukian is my co-chair throughout this Week of Remembrance events. He is going to come on a little bit later and carry on where I leave off. Of course, all under the great tutelage and hard work of Zizette Mullins, who has put it together. Thank you, Zizette. And so at this point, I'd like to welcome you all and invite the mayor of the city of Glendale, Mr. Frank Quintero, to give his remarks. And welcome.
Well, let me start by thanking the committee that does such a wonderful job of putting these events. And as I mentioned, Tuesday night. In fact, some of the committee members have been here from the beginning. This started 11 years ago, and those committee members have just continued to participate, and every year it literally gets better. And once again, any of you that attended the genocide commemoration event at the Alex, I think would agree with me. And the Man's Inhumanity to Man's program also continues to top itself, so I think tonight we're going to be moved by the films and by the speaker. Well, as I mentioned at the genocide commemoration, when I first got involved in the Armenian community, which is back in 1977, I kept listening to the different people that came through my offices, and they all had, I would always ask them, and they all had specific instances. They had specific, they talked about their grandparents. If they were younger people, they talked about their parents or their uncles and aunts. And so what I said the other night, I think holds true for all of us, and that is that when you talk to people who aren't familiar with the Armenian Genocide, or for people that aren't familiar with Darfur, or all of the different events that we've talked about, the Holocaust, to make it personal, to talk about exactly what it was that happened to your family. I think that's the best message. Sometimes when you talk about these huge numbers, 1.8 million Armenians, 6 million Jews, 10 million overall with the German atrocities against other people, you lose fact of the individual people that that affected, their names and what they did for a living and so forth. And so I think that's the greatest memorial, when you can talk to someone and talk about your family, talk about your relatives, and talk about what happened to them. So I'm looking forward to tonight's program. I want to thank Ara and Rafi for doing a wonderful job as the co-chairs this year, and welcome to the city of Glendale.
Well, thank you, everyone. I know you're all waiting, and we're here to see the films that have won the awards, and I believe we're ready to queue up. We're going to start with the third place film by Armen Terzakarian. After the film, I'm going to invite Armen up and each filmmaker to say a few words about his work and any thoughts that he may have on film or his subject or on any topic related to his work. So here's the first film by Armen Terzakarian.
What is never again? Is it an apology to the victims of the pains and injustice done by other humans? Is it an oath to never let the past repeat itself in the future? Is it a promise by the leaders of this world that future generations will not make the same mistakes we saw? Or is it a phrase of empty meaning, with no intention but to quiet those who cry for peace and justice? Whose responsibility is never again? Some have called the Armenian Genocide the blackest page in modern history. The Vatican called it the beginning of the evil of the 20th century. It has been known as Turkey's response to the Armenian question, but Turkey labels these massacres as merely consequences of civil war. The facts are undeniable. 1.5 million Armenians massacred by Ottoman Turkish leaders such as Enver Pasha. The Armenians were forced out of such regions as Western Armenia and Sicilia, lands the Ottoman Empire raided and stole. Over 8 years, millions of Armenians lost their property, their loved ones, their homelands, and for some, even their lives. Thirsty for the extinction of the Armenian race, the Ottoman Turks pressed their campaign very close to Yerevan, the capital city of Armenia they tried to sack without success. The genocide stopped in 1923, so the world had one decade to investigate the remains of the Ottoman Empire, condemn the mass murderers, and prevent ethnic atrocities like these from occurring again.
Mayragan, Hayragan Azgaronov, Bunjia. Tirasvanutenen, Vera Bratsneri, Arachi Serumte. Aysor, aşharmışat mı yerbirnir, ıntunele çeğaz fanktiyonu hayot, miyen Türkiye'ne vurcuktu mu? Kani vur, badas kanıtıyor muydu da? Kani vur, bir de hoğera bir de veredatını. Mü anmağatas nerun temu, hiç vur betke aşharı orinki mec adıga bir de bıçarı. Alpisi bacar neru ve vur, kalkagan bacar neru ve vur çiğntunu.
In 1933, Adolf Hitler oversaw the first act of discrimination against the Jewish race. The only man to publicly protest Hitler was sent to a hard labor camp. No doubt using the Turkish campaign as a model, Hitler and the Nazis carried out their own efforts to eradicate the Jewish race. What began as basic violations of civil rights degenerated into a period of brutality and inhumanity. All Jews were treated like animals. Some were spared death camps by dying in the ghettos. Everyone else was taken away to what the Nazis intended to be their graves. 6 million Jews perished from 1939 to 1945. However, a handful of survivors remained to tell their tales that this black page in humanity's history will never be forgotten.
It wasn't so easy for me to do it, but I do it so people would know. My grandchildren, my great-grandchildren, one day, they would maybe listen and they would see what could happen in life. How can you get used to killing people systematically? Things like that, unbelievable. And now come that fellow inside, it's never happened.
This is the first hand witness, which I am one of them, and lucky to survive. So I owe that to humanity, that at least if I contribute to save one person, that it was worthwhile.
Believe it or not, after so many years, it's very painful to talk. I get tremendous headaches after that, but it's worth it. To inform people is worth it. And I really don't know how long we have on this earth, and as long as we can continue. A lot of people which show the same thing which I did, unfortunately didn't make through the war. So we have to speak for them.
Hopefully, these sad and tragic stories will be a reminder to future generations that when one of us are threatened, when some ethnic groups or religious group are threatened, unless we react to it, we will all become victims, ultimately.
In 1951, members of the United Nations ratified Resolution 260 to create the Genocide Convention. They vowed that never again would any government carry out mass murders intended to destroy any specific race. This was their declaration, that the Holocaust would be the last of its kind. No one would commit genocide for the rest of mankind's history.
Everybody's going to the party, have a real good time.
Do you think that these genocides would have existed at all if the Armenian genocide had been accepted and properly punished?
Այո, ճիշտ է, հասկացա ես հարցը, չէր լինի, եթե ընդունեին, չէր լինի, ինչպես ժամանակին ասել է Հիտլերը, որ հայերի ցեղասպանությունով է հիշում այսօր.
Armen, very moving. So introduce yourself to us. Tell us a little bit about your work.
Hello, my name is Armen Terzikarian. Currently, I'm a freshman at USC, so fight on. I made this movie maybe 5 months ago as part of my class seminar with the Showa Institute Foundation. My professors, Dan Lesham and Mariana Aguilar, helped me a lot to pick this topic, and they had a lot of resources for me to access the testimonies of the Holocaust survivors. And all those pictures were directly from the national website for the Holocaust. What motivated me to make a movie like this was that normally I wasn't talking much about what I felt about these tragedies. I'd go to the events in Little Armenia in Hollywood every year, but I think that when I saw this opportunity to make a movie, I was thinking it's time for me to showcase like what I really feel like, an extension of how these genocides have shaped what I feel. And even though the song choice was controversial to my viewers at USC, I felt that this is probably the most moving way to get people like how I really feel like. Getting angry, or at least getting emotional when this comes up. I like to take this time to thank the tech crew at USC International, IML station, for helping out with the film editing, and with the narration and the sound editing. I'd also like to thank my professors and the Showa Institute for granting access to the VHA, that's where I got my testimonies from. They have about 52,000, and just recently they digitized testimonies from their Armenian survivors. And recently they also digitized testimonies from survivors of the Rwanda genocide. But right now I'd like to thank my grandmother. She was so gracious in granting a few minutes of her time to make this interview. Without her influence and without her emotional support, this movie wouldn't be possible. And I'd like to thank Mom and Dad. Thank you for never letting up. This was annoying. The movie was great, but making it wasn't. This is the first time I used iMovie. And well, very. I understand this is very good. I mean, even for a third place, not bad for a movie that's going to be the first movie ever to be shown in an event like this.
The second place film winners are the daughter and father team of June Masurlian and Peter Masurlian.
This is Auschwitz. It's in the Eastern European country of Poland. During World War II, from 1942 to 1944, more than 1 million innocent men, women, and children died here in what is known as the Holocaust. Most victims were herded into gas chambers and killed, while others died of disease and starvation. 90% of them were Jewish. Overall, 6 million Jews were killed during the war, the so-called Final Solution, initiated by Adolf Hitler and the Nazis. In the history of the world, it is the most devastating genocide, a deliberate and systematic attempt to destroy an entire ethnic, racial, religious, or national group. Bello, where a monument stands to the victims of another government-planned mass killing, the Armenian Genocide. From 1915 to 1923, more than 1.5 million Armenians were shot, stabbed, or starved to death at the hands of the government of Turkey. Many died during death marches in the desert. This is my great-grandfather Benjamin in the late 1950s. He survived the Armenian Genocide and ended up in Wisconsin. His two brothers and mother also survived. His father and five sisters were not so lucky. My great-grandfather was forced to leave the land his ancestors had lived on for 1,000 years, never to see it again. The reason? He was an Armenian Christian. This is my great-grandfather, Lajos. He was a Hungarian Catholic. After World War II, he spent 5 years in a forced labor camp in Siberia. It was all part of Joseph Stalin's plan to build up the Soviet Union. More than 700,000 Hungarians were sent to the labor camps. Nearly half of them died there. It's for these reasons, the experiences of my great-grandfathers, that I have a keen interest in how and why human beings can treat each other so badly. There seems to be no shortage of historical evidence shining a light on man's inhumanity to man. My father has taken me to demonstrations where protesters demand the government of Turkey recognize the Armenian Genocide.
Mr. Kokorian, what do you have to say today?
For the last 2 years, when I was 5 and 6, I had the opportunity to report on these annual protests, giving me more insight into the complicated political nature of the crime of genocide. A few years ago, I met Peter Fischel. Like my mother, he's from Hungary. He survived the Holocaust by hiding in a church, a bakery, and in a basement, all the while carrying a fake ID. He's what they call a hidden child of the Holocaust.
You know something? Heaven knows. Maybe this is where my sister and my bed was. You know, I really don't know exactly. It's not 50 years that we were here, it's 60-some years. I have to live with all these horrors what happened. I have to live, and this is what nobody can escape.
Peter Fischel was just 14 when he spent 4 months hiding from the Nazis. His father did not survive, leaving Peter, his mother and sister, heartbroken. They eventually came to America, where Peter saw this famous picture in a magazine. He identified with the boy in the picture and wrote a poem about it called To the Little Polish Boy Standing with His Arms Up.
I would like to be an artist so I could make a painting of you, little Polish boy,
standing with your little hat on your head, the Star of David on your coat, standing in the ghetto with your arms up, as many Nazi machine guns pointing at you. I would make a monument of you and the world who said nothing. I am not an artist, but my mind had painted a painting of you. I will make this painting so bright that it will blind the eyes of the world who saw nothing. 10 billion miles high will be the monument, so the whole universe can remember of you, little Polish boy. And the monument will tremble, so the blind world now will know what fear is in the darkness. The world who said nothing. I am not a composer, but I will write a composition for 5 trillion trumpets, so it will blast the eardrums of this world. The words who heard nothing. I am sorry that it was you and not me.
Since 1995, Peter Fischel has used the poem to introduce the Holocaust to middle and high school students across the country, speaking in more than 100 schools.
My sister gave me this yellow star. She saved this. I don't know where my yellow star is, and I don't really miss it. And in my poem, I say that, and the world can find out now what is fear in darkness. I experienced it as a child. That came from an experience of mine that I was hiding in an apartment where I was the only person in that apartment. When the Germans came in, I was on the street and I actually saw the Germans marching in. And I ran home and I told my father, I said, Dad, the Germans just came in. I saw them on the streets. Do you think it's possible that all of us are going to be killed now? And he looked in my eyes and he said, yes.
Unfortunately, in the 70 years since the Holocaust, mass killings and genocides persist to this day, leading Mr. Fischel to Arizona to talk to a group of children and adults holding a candlelight vigil to bring attention to the modern-day genocide in the Darfur region of Africa.
I wrote a poem about a world of human beings who ignored a Holocaust of 6 million people, a genocide 65 years ago, and unfortunately the poem is all too appropriate for what has since happened in Cambodia, in Rwanda, in Kosovo, or as is the case today in Darfur.
A few years ago, Peter was the guest of honor at a high school in Chino Hills, where some kids put on a play based on the novel Playing for Time, written by a survivor of the Auschwitz death camp. She survived because she and a few other classical musicians were not killed by their Nazi captors because they performed for them.
As a Holocaust survivor, it was an extra special event for me watching this play with this unbelievable, extraordinary cast.
A couple of years later, Peter was stunned to read about a fourth grade girl from Fountain Valley who had dressed up like the little Polish boy and performed Peter's poem at school. He paid a visit to her class
to thank her for keeping alive the memory of the Holocaust and the little Polish boy.
His poem is being used not just to teach about the Holocaust, but to teach about tolerance in modern day, race, how people look, and religion.
You see, Peter is a Holocaust survivor whose father was killed by the Nazis when he was only 14 years old.
For his efforts, Peter received the Hero in Education Award from the California Lottery. He's created posters, a medallion, and a book, and commissioned a lesson plan on how to teach the Holocaust to middle and high school students.
Thank you so much for sharing this with us. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, Peter Fischel, our volunteer hero in education. Thank you so much.
Peter Fischel is most proud of his display at the Museum of Tolerance in Los Angeles. He often speaks at the museum and has his picture on the wall, showcasing his fellow Holocaust survivors who volunteer their time there.
What Peter is doing is not only remarkable because of the courage that a person has to every day relive a tragic part of his life. When a survivor does that, they ensure the continuity of human civilization based on tolerance, because they tell the world, look where inhumanity has led us in the past.
Why is a child dangerous? Because a child is the embodiment of the future. And Peter, what you've done in enhancing this with your poetry, your own contribution, is to see it through the eyes of one who experienced that powerlessness, of one who experienced that victimization, and one who understands that the photograph is a plea for human decency and human dignity.
In March of 2012, I had the opportunity to sit down with Peter Fischel next to his display on the fourth floor of the Museum of Tolerance.
We've heard the expression never again, but these terrible things keep happening. What is it in human beings that lead them to do this?
People looking for scapegoats, to put the blame on somebody. The people who would follow them, the factor is fear. And people follow orders because they are afraid that they're gonna be the first one shot to death.
What do world leaders and everybody else, for that matter, need to do to prevent genocide from happening in the future?
The world leaders definitely should make it sure that in the education they have included the genocide and the Holocaust and teach it to their children.
There's no doubt the world has been and will continue to be a dangerous place. Some still view the future with hope, others with a stark realism.
We live in a world where Ahmadinejad says that the Holocaust, what Peter is talking about, is a lie. It's a myth. It never happened. And that's why what Peter does is invaluable. What he's doing is not doing something for the past. We can't undo the past. It's already happened. But what he's doing is protecting the future.
Since you survived the Holocaust 67 years ago, do you think the world has made any progress towards stopping massacres and genocides?
Yes. In my personal opinion, that is progress. The most important thing is that we're talking about it. We do not turn our head. When you go down to the museum on the first floor and look my picture, I'm stating, never turn your head. That's very important. If you don't, not gonna get involved and you're gonna turn ahead, things not gonna go away. You have to do something and stop the insanity.
Peter, come up. Excellent work.
Good evening, everyone. It is truly an honor to be included among the winners in tonight's important event. My sincere hand of appreciation is extended to all of you who cared enough to come out tonight. I would like to thank the City of Glendale's annual commemorative event committee, the judges, and all of those who worked so hard to make tonight possible. Special thanks to Zazette Mullins, Glendale's community outreach coordinator. I've been working alongside my father since I was 5 years old. With every new video project, I gain a greater understanding of the world I live in and the ways we must work together to find solutions. As a 7-year-old first grader, I am mostly interested in dinosaurs, fairies, and swans. But my father does try to expand my worldview by explaining current events to me, as well as history, our tragic family history that 4 generations later led to my wonderful life here in America, and more specifically, Glendale. As we will hear from Peter Fischel a little later, there is hope and progress when it comes to the long history of man's inhumanity to man. But my father has urged me to heed the warning of Mr. Fischel and never turn your head. We live in a country of unique freedoms. We should not squander our opportunity to speak for the weak, in America or around the world. We should not fear politicians or governments who might choose to abuse their power to keep us from speaking up. Our humanity should not allow us to keep silent. I will end with a quote from Jewel, one of my favorite singers, in the song Hands. She says, "We must fight, not out of spite, for someone must stand up for what's right, because where there's a man who has no voice, there I shall go singing." I hope I can live up to that concept as I grow up. And I hope everyone in this room is or becomes an effective soldier in the war to give voice to those people who, for whatever their circumstances, need someone to champion their cause. Thank you.
Our first place prize winner is Colin McDowell, who prepared a film entitled Stuck in Traffic.
No one will come in and help you. These girls essentially are getting a death sentence.
My daughter counts and she matters. She's my child.
There's been times I've been locked up in jail and as safe as I could get. And I felt freedom in prison.
The girls that are in it right now, I just can't do anything but hope for them. They're stuck. They're completely stuck in traffic. I was friends with this person. She protected me. She was, you know, she was my best friend. And then she sold me to a group of guys.
One of the first responses I get when I tell people what I do is, well, why bother? These girls want to do this. Like, that's the image. They willingly came to this. They're 14 years old. They knew what they were getting into. The truth of the matter is, most of them don't know what they're getting themselves into.
Nobody grows up thinking, I want to be a prostitute when I grow up. You know, I want to be a drug addict. I want to be beat up every day when I grow up. Nobody says that. And for anybody to think that people choose that life, they have to be ignorant. They don't understand.
Once you've done inflicted enough damage to these girls emotionally, psychologically, they'll stay because they've been broken.
When I'm right next to her, I told her, you better not be doing this crap. So as soon as you guys get around, I'll be out.
It's all money driven. It's who can get the most money.
especially among the pimps. He's being real nice and everything, giving her what she wants. And then down the road, it's back to where, hey, you need to go make me some more money. It's all about the money coming in.
He was making probably 14, maybe 15,000 a week off of me alone.
You're not immune. You're not immune to this. This happens to all kinds of families.
It is astounding how easy, you know, you could be a victim of this crime.
They don't have the freedom to come home. They don't choose this lifestyle. You know, they get conned into it, but once they're in, there's no way out.
The thing that parents can do at a tactical level is to ensure that they are aware of what happens in places like malls, which is the main place that recruiters will approach young girls.
They're in the malls every day, and they know what to look for. They know that it's the girls that are being dropped off with their friends. They sweet talk the girls, you know? They know what girls need to hear, what they want to hear. You know, you're so pretty. Can I take your picture?
These recruiters are very, very smart. They know how to approach a girl. They will take three girls that they target. They will identify the more attractive girl and the less attractive girl, and they will target the middle girl, because the middle girl is the one that's the most insecure.
I think choosing prostitution to survive is different than sex trafficking, because they're doing that to make their money, but sex trafficking is being held against your will.
My name is Tina. I'm 44. I've been doing this since I was 29. The lifestyle is, for me, it's been comfortable. Just like I said, I have the freedom to do what I want when I want. I don't have to answer to anybody. I believe in freedom of choice, you know. If you want to do it, that's fine. But these kids that are just teenagers and babies, they don't know any better, man.
That's a grooming. We didn't know what it was at the time. You know, like, they wouldn't let her speak, they didn't let her shower, they didn't let her eat.
They will most often keep her without any clothes on for a period of a couple of weeks. They will have what's called a coming out party, where she'll be raped by as many as 10 men, kept in a very enclosed area. Some use dog crates, some use dresser drawers, some use, they tie them up and put them under beds. It takes about 14 days. And once they do that for 14 days, the young girl is then completely broken.
Girls get beaten and raped for 2 weeks straight. And then once they're conditioned, you're a completely different person. You don't even know who you are.
I know the shame that they have to go through, feeling alone, feeling like nobody really care about them, feeling like nobody really love them. You know, and feeling like the streets is the only way that they can make it, or the only way out. They have to be out here selling their body. That's a lie from the hell.
He had me working at this facility where men would come in and they would refuse the other girls. And I look young at my age now. When I was 16, I looked all of about 13 years old.
The demand for girls involved in sex trafficking is very high the younger they are. And that is for a number of reasons. First of all, the Johns, who are the customers, if you will, prefer young girls because they are less likely to have disease, less likely to have a lot of partners in their past. And so the demand is very high.
I mean, who would want to have sex with a baby? I mean, that's a baby to me. That's just crazy.
13, 14-year-old babies out here, that's where the line gets drawn. When you see 14, 15-year-old babies out here getting murdered, getting raped, coming up pregnant, being forced to be out here, I can't accept that.
I know that there's a demand out there for young girls, and that's why they target them. Because, you know, you can get on Craigslist and shit like that, and, you know, these guys will pay a couple thousand dollars for a little girl. And that's even more sick.
you will need a place to advertise it, because in order to make money, you have to promote your business. And if you have girls locked up in a house, you have to figure out a way to get people to your house. It's much more profitable for you than drugs or weapons, for just this reason that human beings are transferable and you can use them over and over again.
I've learned that these pimps will tell the girls that nobody cares about them, that they're garbage. Nobody loves them. They're disgusting now. They are foul now. They'll tell them that the police don't care about them.
The girls have been coached by the traffickers to say, this is what you're going to say when the police show up, that this was voluntary, that you came, you know, under your own will, that I pay you. And if you don't, I'll kill you.
Johns are everybody. High business, low business, painters. Some had wedding rings on still, some didn't have wedding rings on.
Picture your dad or your uncle or somebody, you know, families, wives. I mean, I've got guys that take me to their house and their wife will be at work. Their kids will be at school.
There were all sorts of weirdos, and some guys would just come in and have me do what I had to do, and then they'd get up and walk off, never saying a word or anything. Some of them forgot to take their wedding rings off before they would come in, and it was dirty.
Every night, you take a chance and you run a risk of losing your life. Your life every time. But you get in them cars and you thinking, maybe this gonna be the one where you get that good lick, where you get that come up lick, where you can go and just relax for a week.
And he asked me what I wanted to do during clients while I was left at this facility, and I was coloring. I mean, I'm sitting here doing, like, having sex with people, and in between I'm coloring in a coloring book like a little five-year-old girl or something, because that's what they brought me down to, was just completely demeaned me.
The beatings, the fighting, and the hurting, and the disrespect. I'm already broken and bruised. Then you have a person coming beating on you, misusing you, disrespecting you, not caring about you, mentally, emotionally, and physically abusing you. Not fair to a child.
If there's no Johns, there's no little girls being kidnapped, there's no women being kidnapped, they need to realize that even though they're only fulfilling a fantasy for 5 or 10 minutes, they're contributing to something so much bigger than themselves.
They need to understand that what they're doing is wrong, not only in the eyes of our city and in our moral and legal system, but it's wrong in the eyes of God. There will be a day that they will have to answer to what they're doing.
You touched my daughter. Just shame on you. Just shame on you.
You know what? I felt hopeless. I felt like, and a lot of women that died, and unfortunately, there's a lot of people that's gonna die feeling hopeless. But I know that there is hope. There is hope. There's hope because today, there's people that's choosing to do something about it. There's people that's willing to give their time, their energy, however they can, to bring these babies out. So there's hope.
if people just knew what it was and then it stood up to it, that puts the brakes on that cycle.
You're trapped. Because now that you know it, you have to do something about it. You cannot do nothing. Because it boils down to whether you want to help these girls more than the terrible people who are keeping them captive and torturing them.
If you love your child, you keep them safe. And part of keeping them safe is preparing them.
More than anything, I always see this work as making sure that these girls are given an option, an opportunity to get out of such a horrible and heinous crime or criminal industry and do something with their lives.
You don't have to be out here. You're not alone. If I had asked somebody just came and just said that to me, my life probably would have been a whole different life.
Slept, woke up, had sex with people, slept, woke up, had sex with people, and that's what I did. And I remember people that worked with my pimp coming in and being like, girl, you need to wake up, you're sleeping your life away. And then I like looked up at him and gave him this really dirty look, like, what life? I was dead inside.
Colin McDowell, our first prize winner. Let's hear it.
First of all, I want to apologize for being late. I had trouble getting out of work on time. Second of all, this film was made, it was actually made in Arizona. It was made while I was a student at Arizona State University in 2010. And I was the editor and camera person for this film. There was also three other people involved in putting it together that aren't able to be here tonight. As for the subject matter, I had no idea what sex trafficking even was. I thought the prostitution and sex trafficking was the same thing until we delved into this subject and I really opened my eyes to that. So that was our main focus, was just bringing awareness to the issue, because we can't really go out ourselves and, you know, help these girls and literally pick them up off the street. So we did what we were able to do by just bringing awareness to this. And hopefully, if you didn't know about this, you now know a little bit about it. It's actually a 30-minute documentary. I made a short 15-minute version for the event tonight. And we actually, I think it's available to view online on IMDb for free, and we also offer it for $9.95, where all the proceeds go to organizations who are fighting sex trafficking, specific safe houses, because there's new safe houses that are opening up all around the country that actually bring these girls in and kind of nurse them back into health. That's it, I guess. I don't know if anybody has any questions. Thank you. And I do just want to say thank you to the city of Glendale for having this event, because I mean, it is extremely important, no matter what heinous issue or crime is going on, that the stuff's known about. So thank you.
Please stay on the stage. Okay. Colin, please stay on the stage, and will the team of Peter and June, as well as Armin, please come up. We'd like to present your awards and do a drawing amongst you for a special prize. OK? And Mr. Manoukian, Rafi?
Armin, congratulations, great job.
Do you get this? June, do you get this or does your dad? Or your agent? Okay. To the ANCA. Thank you. Is it there? Is it signed? Okay. And our first prize to Colin. Now we have a drawing amongst the top three. Your names have been placed, and let me introduce Christian. Christian is the director of the International Academy of Film and Television, located on San Fernando Road in Burbank. And Christian, let me ask you to step forward and introduce your school and what we're doing here.
Oh, thank you so much, thank you. Yes, good evening, everyone. I'm from the International Academy of Film and Television. We're a new film school in the Burbank-Glendale area. And we believe that successful storytelling involves having the ability to tell genuine stories to a global audience. And these days, it is the power of film. We are here because we resonate with the stories that are being told this evening, and because we want to give the community of Burbank and Glendale more opportunities to tell stories on film. So we are located at 635 South San Fernando Boulevard, and when we found out about this event, we wanted to give back, and so this evening we are giving scholarships to 15 people in the audience here for summer programs. And I'm very proud to announce that in a minute we will be honoring one of these filmmakers with a diploma program in filmmaking, which is a one-year program studying film at our school. Thank you very much.
Okay, so the names have been placed in a hopper, and we're gonna ask Zizette to present it to a member of the audience to pull the winning name for a one-year scholarship. Is it transferable?
The scholarship is to the filmmaker.
To the filmmaker.
Yes.
Armin. Winner is Armin.
Thank you. And thank you to Councilmember Arna Jarian, who did a great job. Please give him a big hand. These short films certainly touch home for me in terms of the issue of men's inhumanity to men. We recognize today that it's not just about genocides, it's not just about it's not just about Holocausts. It is about people, and it is about loving your neighbor and loving yourself and your family. So that is very important. It is my distinct privilege today to be given the task of introducing Peter Fischel. However, I believe that after June Masurlian introduced him in such a wonderful way, all I will say is that the work that Mr. Fischel is doing with the youth is the most important thing that I took from this short movie, and the work that what I've learned from what I've read so far from him, because the youth are our future. And if we teach our youth what these acts of inhumanity are, we will have a better future. So please welcome Mr. Peter Fisher. Thank you.
How are you? I am Peter, and thank you, Mr. Mayor, and the rest of you for inviting me and taking a chance as what I will do here now. Many people think as I'm a success. I am definitely not success. Financially, I am very successful morally. And the way I achieve moral success, that I steal a lot. And my biggest catch was, I have read Albert Speer's book, 20 years in Nuremberg. And Albert Speer was a very, very talented architect in Germany. His father was a sensation also. Interestingly enough, his father hated Adolf Hitler, but chance brought it that Göring needed his house, made it a little bit more modern, better looking. So he researched the field and found Albert Speer as an architect to do this job. Albert Speer worked for Göring for quite a while and done a sensational job. Göring recommended Albert Speer to Adolf Hitler to do jobs at his palace. That's how Albert Speer and Adolf Hitler met. As much as I hate Adolf Hitler, I have to admit I have seen Adolf Hitler try to be an artist in his younger years, and he done some postcards. And I have to admit, they had some merit in them. He didn't make postcards with gas chambers. He made, if you do research and go to some libraries, you're going to find those artworks I'm talking about. And it was our loss that nobody recognized him, so he had to look for another job. And it's interesting, as far as getting a dictator job, it's really not difficult. You have to go to a psychiatrist and get some drug which makes you absolutely insane, unreliable, and an SOB. And then you qualify becoming a leader, like in Germany when Bismarck needed somebody. And Adolf Hitler was available, and he absolutely fit this category. Just like Joseph Stalin, Napoleon wasn't any better. And I would very much urge you if you like me, whenever you write these people's name down, don't ever use capital letters. As a matter of fact, I am planning to write Webster Dictionary, a long letter with this suggestion. So please don't try to steal it. Or if you want to, it's all right. As long as they do the changes. And I'm going to see, well, naturally, my name has to be in very large letters, but Napoleon and Attila the Hun, it's interesting that in my so-called career, if you can call this career, I am trying to learn from everyone. I listened one time the Russian Lenin spoke, and he said, I would make a deal with the devil if that would bring communism farther ahead. And I can say I want to copy him. And I am willing, if the devil is listening, make various deals with the devil as long as I can prevent another Holocaust. And if I can make people love each other, if I can make children not to drop out from schools, wives and husbands faithful to each other, because nobody is really any better. Just comes something into my mind. The name is Jürgen. Oh, yes. I forgot the whole thing about Albert Speer. Albert Speer, and I'm thinking of because June Mazurlian mentioned, quoted me, thank you, never turn your head. And it's in the Simon Wiesenthal Museum displayed my statement. And I learned that from Albert Speer, that when he was at the prison serving 20 years, he wrote a book. He wrote it on toilet paper and had it smuggled out with the guards. And then it was published after he served his 20 years. And he writes about that Adolf Hitler sent him to Gestapo headquarters. And when he walked through, he looked to the right, and he saw blood flowing out under the door. He stopped for a second and started thinking, what shall I do? Go back and report this to Adolf Hitler or not? If I report him, he might become very angry and fires me, maybe even sends me to a death camp with my family. So he never reported this to Adolf Hitler. And that, what he said, in my mind, was a very, very smart statement. He turned his head from the blood which was flowing out, and he should have went back and spoken to Hitler and telling him how it is. He didn't. He spent 20 years in prison. So I would advise everybody, never turn your head. Thank you, Peter. There was a man named Jürgen Stroop, Adolf Hitler's commissioned him to take care of the Warsaw Ghetto Uprising. Young Jewish kids were fighting the big Nazi army, the best goose steppers in the world, because when it came to attack one person and use 50, that was the kind of people they were excellent in. And Jurgen's troop took over to take over the Warsaw Ghetto Uprising, but Adolf Hitler thought it gonna take 2 days. And in 3 weeks, they were still fighting. And Jurgen's troop, you can go to the Simon Wiesenthal Library in the bookstore and find his notes. Jurgen's troop's notes were found by the liberating Americans in 1945. And he calls the Jews sub-heroes in his book. The way they fought the Nazis in the Warsaw Ghetto Uprising. So, I deeply hope that we never have to come and things look good, that we're never gonna have another Holocaust. But heaven forbids if it happens, follow the Jewish people in Poland in 1943, what they done. Follow them and don't think of the Polish jokes. God bless you.
Thank you, Mr. Fischel. I'm sure and I'm certain that everyone will take those words to heart, take them home and share them with their loved ones, their families, their friends. That's how the word gets around, is by sharing it. As we were saying earlier, sharing the stories, the individual stories with our friends and our loved ones. Next, we have a drawing again for the International Academy of Film and Television. So the winners have been picked. Right. The winners have been picked, and this is an award of $23,000 divided by 15 individuals, right? And scholarships in commemoration of the Week of Remembrance. So I want to thank the International Academy of Film and Television. Thank you for this. Please give him a hand. And I will announce the winners and they'll go to Christian over there. Okay, we have Robert Peters.
Arthur Babayan. Wins a scholarship to the effects program.
Okay, Robert Peters was to the acting workshop.
Okay, why don't the winners come up and join us if you're here. They should be here.
MC Wida to voiceover program.
Lily Avagian. In the summer program in acting.
Arno Babayan.
Put acting and get up here.
Effects program.
Artak Martirosyan in the voiceover program.
Ani Nazarian for the Camp Hollywood.
Could be Osped. Is it Osped or Osred Bogarian?
Osped. John Karakov Sayan to the Camp Hollywood again.
Daniel Bowen to the voiceover program.
David Avagyan, summer program.
Kay Muradyan to the effects program.
Mark Moss to the acting workshop. Stephen Gimian to the acting workshop again. And Ani Pogarian to Camp Hollywood. Congratulations to all of you.
And congratulations to the winners. Before everyone leaves, there's another gift for each and every one of you at the table there, the International Academy of Film and Television, a small gift and token of appreciation to the community, although I don't know what else this school could do to the community. They've done so much already. We're so glad to have them be a part of our city and our programs. Thank you, Christian.
And again, I want to thank the library staff, the city staff who put this event together, as well as the whole week itself. I want to thank council member, my co-chair, council member Najarian, for co-chairing this event with me. And I want to thank all of you for participating today. We certainly learned very important lessons about man's inhumanity to man today, and I hope that we can share it with others and next year make it an event with more of a larger attendance, I'll put it that way. So thank you all very much. I also want to thank our committee members.
Yes.
Who have worked diligently for months to help us put this event together. So thank you all. Where is Zizette? I want to thank Zizette as well. Thank you all and have a good evening.